Okay. Now, Ashok Kulkarni, I remember in the 80s when we were fascinated with S35 labeled in situs, and I was there in the dark room processing these in situs, looking at gene expression and overlapping and unique. Came this era of transgene methodology, transformed our field because it gave us the in vivo models for human disease. And Dr. Kulkarni actually forged a path. He created for NIDCR, I think that was under Slavkin and then Dr. Tabak's support, the transgenic core facility there. But you came in with a wealth of your own experiences in the field of CDK. I remember Anita Roberts and TGF-beta-1. Can you share with us your experiences and your vision for the future, Ashok?
Sure. I think as all of us know, the transgenic models now are the gold standard for analyzing the gene functions in development and disease. And our journey at NIDCR started 25 years ago when the transgenic core was started in 1995. And since then, we have made about 2,500 transgenic mouse lines and more than 100 knockout models. And what I would like to do is to just share with you some of the prominent mouse models that we made. And the first one that comes to my mind is the AI model. In collaboration with Caroline Gibson of UPenn and Tim Wright of UNC, we knocked out amelogenin and made this amelogenin knockout model that typically displayed all the AI defects. But not only that, it helped us to analyze the amelogenin gene, the splice isoforms, and how they impact the enamel mineralization. The next model we met, I think in collaboration with Mary McDougall and Rena, actually, when Rena was at Texas University, we made the DSPP knockout, and that was for DGI, dentinogenesis imperfecta. And that mimicked, typically, debate that time was whether it mimicked DGI2 or DGI3. But now the nomenclature has changed so much. But again, that model helped us to define two different entities of DSPP, DSP and DPP. So very valuable mouse model. The third group that comes to my mind is the TGF beta. And as you know, it's a multifunctional cytokine family, large number of members there. So in collaboration with late Anita Roberts, who discovered TGF-beta and pioneered the research, we met large number of mouse models. We collaborated with Sharon Wall and analyzed the function of TGF-beta in the immune system, inflammation, fibrosis, and also in oral cancer. So that was the third group that comes to my mind. The fourth group is the skeletal proteins. And I remember, I think we met the first mouse model for Marian, biglycan and other skeletal proteins. And that mimicked typically some of the common bone diseases. So that was another group that, also with Pam's group, we developed another skeletal protein knockout model. You'll see one of the slides that shows the striking phenotype in the MMT1 knockout model. I think that was it in collaboration with Pam's group. So that was the fourth group that comes to my mind. Another group is the sensory biology, which is now another one of the components of our mission critical research area. So we developed quite a few models to study the pain signaling pathway. We found CDK5, one of the important neuronal kinase in one peripheral vein. We also made mouse models for test receptor for Nick Reba's lab. Also to study each mechanism for Mark Hoon's lab. So sensory biology, we made quite a few mouse models. And last but not the least is the salivary gland area. We made mouse models for studying the salivary gland physiology, and dry mouth, and Sjogren's syndrome, and as well as for oral cancer and head and neck squamous cell carcinoma. So I think we covered almost all the mission critical areas. And as to the challenges, I see in the next 5 years is the technology. And so as some of you know, we started with the ES cells, and then we were waiting for chimeras, and then waiting for knockouts almost months and years. But then now it has jumped to the CRISPR. We can make a knockout, we used to make a knockout model in 3 years, if you're lucky. Now we can make a knockout model in 3 months. But still there are challenges, the one for making the flux models using the donor DNA. So I think challenge is going to be keeping space with the advancing technology. But what we would like to do is to continue our partnership with the extramural community and make the mouse models and share with them. Another thing that we have done is we shared all the mouse models with the extramural community and deposited them in Jackson Lab repository so that they're freely available.
So amongst all the models that you that replicate in vivo situations, what to you was the most striking resemblance to human condition, the one that mimicked? I would favor DSPP, but that's because we were.
No, I think one of the models that not highlighted within the NIDCR is the Fabry mouse model. And Fabry is a very painful fetal disease. It affects certain populations. And when we made this mouse model, one thing it resembles Fabry disease, but at the same time, it is not fetal. It is a very subtle phenotype. And that is being now used in a number of different biotech companies to develop gene therapies for Fabry disease and also for stem cell therapies. I think that's one of the very striking model that is very popular for developing therapies.
Absolutely. So I'm sure many of you in the extramural world are using these models. So that's great direction for the future. Thank you.